ओके, तो आई थिंक इन द लास्ट लेक्चर वी टॉक्ड अबाउट द पार्टिकल एस्पेक्ट ऑफ वेव्स, राइट? सो वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट द फर्स्ट थिंग वॉज द ब्लैक बॉडी रेडिएशन. सो आई टोल्ड यू दैट दिस इज द स्पेक्ट्रल एनर्जी डेंसिटी वर्सेस फ्रीक्वेंसी कर्व. एंड फाइनली प्लैंक वॉज एबल टू एक्सप्लेन और थियोरेटिकली गेट द करेक्ट फॉर्मूला टू एक्सप्लेन दिस काइंड ऑफ अ बिहेवियर फॉर स्पेक्ट्रल डेंसिटी वर्सेज फ्रीक्वेंसी. एंड द मेन कॉन्सेप्ट देयर वॉज दैट ही कंसिडर्ड दैट एनर्जी एक्सचेंज बिटवीन मैटर एंड रेडिएशन इज इन टर्म्स ऑफ इज इन डिस्क्रीट पैकेट्स एंड दोज डिस्क्रीट पैकेट्स आर बेसिकली नथिंग बट इंटीजर मल्टीपल्स ऑफ एच न्यू. ओके, तो राइट, सो ई इज इक्वल टू एन एच न्यू इज वॉट द बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट वॉज. Then there was another experiment or another phenomena that people were observing, which was the photoelectric effect, right? So in the photoelectric effect, what happened was if you radiate a metal with light, then some electrons will be ejected. But the electrons will only be ejected if the incident light frequency is greater than some threshold frequency. And so Einstein used the same concept that Planck came up with, where E is equal to nh nu. So he considered that photons are these discrete particles. So light is made up of these discrete particles called photons. And so the energy exchange again is E equal to nh nu. And so he was able to explain the kinetic energy of the ejecting electrons as well. And this was the photoelectric effect. So today we are going to look at the third phenomena, which is very important when talking about the particle aspect of waves, which is the Compton effect. Okay, so in Compton effect, what happens is, so this experiment was actually performed with the help of X-rays, but you can consider any radiation, right? So when radiation are scattered off free electrons, so suppose you have some radiation and there is an electron which is in space, it is free. Now, if you attack this electron with some radiation, what happens is this electron is going to get scattered. Okay. So this electron is going to get, let me, okay. So this electron is going to get scattered, and the incident radiation that is also going to be scattered. Okay. So this is what happens in Compton effect. So let me read the statement. When radiation are scattered off free electrons, wavelength of scattered radiation is larger than wavelength of incident radiation. Okay, so after scattering, so initially before scattering, there is some incident photon and it is coming with a certain frequency or certain wavelength. And after being scattered because of the electron, the wavelength is going to change, and it is saying the Compton effect is saying that the wavelength of the scattered photon is greater than the wavelength of the incident photon. Okay, so this is what the Compton effect tells us. So now we have to see, right, why is this happening? Why is the wavelength of the scattered photon is greater than the wavelength of the incident photon? So what we do is we apply two principles which we know very well, which is conservation of momentum and conservation of energy. Okay, so P is your momentum over here. P is the momentum of incident photon. E is the energy of the incident photon. So this photon or this light is coming with a certain frequency. And so energy is going to be given by h nu. Okay, and then this is the energy of the electron at rest. Okay, so E naught. And so because the electron is at rest, there is no momentum for the electron which is at rest, okay? But then after being hit with the incident radiation, the electron is scattered, so the electron has moved. So there is a momentum associated with the recoiling electron. And of course, the recoiling electron will also have some energy, which will be different from the E naught, okay? And then the scattered photon will also have some momentum and some energy. So P dash and E dash. Okay, so now we apply these principles, conservation of momentum and conservation of energy. Okay, so conservation of momentum tells us that momentum of the incident photon is going to be equal to मोमेंटम ऑफ द रिकॉइलिंग इलेक्ट्रॉन प्लस मोमेंटम ऑफ द स्कैटर्ड फोटॉन्स, राइट? एंड कंजर्वेशन ऑफ एनर्जी टाइटल्स दैट एनर्जी ऑफ इंसिडेंट फोटॉन प्लस एनर्जी ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन एट रेस्ट इज इक्वल टू एनर्जी ऑफ रिकॉइलिंग इलेक्ट्रॉन प्लस एनर्जी ऑफ द स्कैटर्ड फोटॉन्स. ओके, so using, so I'm not going to go through the derivation. You can, if you are interested, you can look at the book and see the full derivation, because the complete derivation is not really important for this course at least. But I just wanted to give you an idea that this is how, this is the basic starting point of this derivation. Okay, so after using these conservation of momentum and conservation of energy, and of course you can write E in terms of h nu, and P also can be written in terms of the kinetic energy and all of that. So if you do all that, finally you will get, right, and then there is an angle at which it is getting scattered. So all of this, if you include, finally you're going to get that the shift in lambda, which is lambda dash minus lambda, so lambda of wavelength of the scattered photon minus wavelength of the incident photon, so this is shift in lambda, the delta lambda is equal to 2 lambda c into sine square theta by 2, and lambda c is nothing but h by, okay, so lambda c is nothing but h by m e into c. Okay, so Planck's constant by mass of electron into the speed of light. Okay, so now you can see that, yeah, any question? Okay, so all right, so now you can see that this shift in lambda is only proportional to the angle, right? So sine of theta, sine square of theta by 2, so it does not depend on the frequency, right? So wavelength shift depends only on the angle at which the incident radiation is scattered and not on frequency of the incident photons. Okay, so what this shows is that, so imagine if you have two bullets, okay, one bullet is at rest, another bullet is hitting the other bullet which is at rest, then the two bullets will get scattered, okay, and there will be some angle at which they will be scattered. So here it is saying that because the wavelength shift does not depend on the frequency of incident photon but only on the angle at which it was scattered, this kind of effect is representative of when two particles are colliding. Okay, so this kind of effect, it shows that the wave has a particle nature. That's what it means. So therefore, Compton effect shows that photons behave like particles. So the photon is attacking the electron. So when photon hits the electron, the photon is scattered in one direction, electron is scattered in the other direction, and these two behave like particles. So the photon behaves like particles, that is, they collide with electrons like material particles. So this is what we mean by Compton effect. Okay, so this is the only formula that you can remember from this, which is delta lambda s 2 lambda c into sine square theta by 2. Okay. So this is just a small homework problem. So all of these homework problems, at least in this chapter that I've given you, they will take less than, I think, 2 minutes to do, because it's just putting in the values in the formulas and then just using the calculator and coming up with the final solution. Okay, so there's not much thinking that is required. So I'll just read it out once. So high energy photons are scattered from electrons initially at rest. Assume photons are backscattered. So backscattered means this theta. Okay, backscattered means electron is going all the way there. Okay, so what is it? Electrons or photons? Assume photons are backscattered. So if photons are backscattered, means instead of going here, it is going back, which means the angle theta is nothing but pi. Okay, so that is what it means by backscattered. So photons are backscattered and their energies are much larger than the electron's rest mass energy. So E is much, much larger than E, ne c square. So basically, after using all the formula, you can use this approximation and you will basically, you can simplify some of some term over here in the energy term. So the first question is calculate the wavelength shift. So wavelength shift or easily you can calculate. You just have to calculate delta lambda by putting in the theta value to be pi. Then B, show that the energy of the scattered photon is half the rest mass energy of the electron, regardless of the energy of the incident photon. So all you have to do is you have to use the energy conservation principle and get the energy of the scattered photon. Then third is calculate the electron's recoil kinetic energy if the energy of the incident photon is 150 MeV. Okay, so this is also simple. So you can do this problem. Okay. All right. So far we have seen that we have seen particle aspect of waves. Okay. So we have seen three phenomena. One was black body radiation, one was the photoelectric effect, and the third one was Compton effect. So all of these three showed that the radiation behaves like particles. Now we come to the other aspect. Okay, so de Broglie was the first one to propose that not only do waves show particle characteristics, but particles also show wave properties. Okay, and this is called the wave-particle duality. So he suggested that every material property, okay, should display a dual wave-particle behavior. So every material particle should display the wave property as well. This is what he proposed. Okay, now in proposing that, first we have to see what are the terms you associate with particles, or what are the quantities you associate with particles, and what are the quantities you associate with waves. So any particle, so particle is basically characterized by a momentum p. Okay, so if photons exhibit wave-particle duality, okay, then particle behavior p should be related to the wave behavior, right? So the momentum should be related to some wavelength or frequency or something like that. Okay, so he came up with that lambda, the wavelength, is equal to h by p. Okay, so wave is characterized by two things. One is wavelength, one is the wave vector, right? Wave vector is also part of the wave. So, and wave vector is given by k, which is 2 pi by lambda into n. Okay, so n will represent the direction of the wave, and this is just the magnitude of the wave vector, which is 2 pi by lambda. Okay. So lambda is h by p, and if k is equal to 2 pi by lambda into n, then you can just substitute for lambda using h by p, and finally you will get k, the wave vector, is equal to p, right? The vector p, which is the momentum vector p, by h cross, and h cross is h by 2 pi. So h cross is something that you will see again and again in quantum mechanics. It's just a simple way of writing down h by 2 pi, because h by 2 pi most often come together. And so you write h by 2 pi as h cross. So wave vector is given by the momentum vector p by h cross. Okay, so these two relations, okay, these two relations are known as de Broglie relations. Okay, so de Broglie stated that each material particle of momentum p behaves as a group of waves whose wavelength and wave vector are given by these two relations. Okay, and these relations are known as de Broglie's relations. Okay, de Broglie's relations are going to become very important. So this was something that de Broglie proposed, but how do we confirm that particles behave like waves, right? There should be some experimental confirmation also that particles are going to behave like waves. So the first thing that people saw was, of course, the particle has to be of the microscopic nature, so microscopic size. So people started working with electron, because electron they thought is of course a particle, right? Because it has a certain size and stuff. So it is a particle. So they looked at electron and they thought, okay, let's try our experiments with electron and see if we can confirm the de Broglie relation. So there were two experiments which are very, of course there were other experiments, these two experiments, but these two experiments were the pioneering experiments, you can say. So the first experiment was the Davison-Germer experiment, and the second one was the Thomson experiment. So both these experiments, what they did was they scattered electrons and showed that these scattered electrons show a diffraction pattern. And diffraction pattern is a characteristic of waves. So what is a diffraction pattern? I think I will explain more in the next lecture, But you can just imagine that the diffraction pattern is something which has a light region, dark region, light region, dark region, like that, one after the other. So that is something like a diffraction pattern. Okay, and that kind of pattern only waves show. Okay, it's only light or something like that shows diffraction pattern. And because electrons are showing such a diffraction pattern, they thought that they finally concluded that electrons also show wave behavior. So let's look at what these experiments are. So the first one is the Davison-Germer experiment. Okay. So what they did in this experiment is that they scattered 54 electron volt of monoenergetic beam of electrons. Okay. So there is an electron source, and from this electron source, they are passing or irradiating this nickel crystal with some electron beam, and the energy of that electron beam is 54 electron volt. Okay, so there is a nickel crystal placed here. There is this electron source, and this electron source is pushing out electrons, and this electron beam is then hitting the nickel crystal, and because it's hitting the nickel crystal, it will be scattered back, so it will finally be reflected and be and they can look at it at the electron detector, okay, where the position of the reflected electrons and stuff like that, they can look at it at the electron detector. So these are the angles. So if the electron source is coming in like this and it is being reflected like this, then this total angle is theta. So you can divide it in half at the plane, at the right at the 90 degree of the nickel crystal, and you will see that this side is theta by 2, this side is theta by 2. And the angle with the plane of the nickel crystal is going to be phi on both the sides. Okay. So they did this, and what was the observation? The observation was that even though electrons were scattered in all directions from the crystal, right? Because here the electrons will obviously be scattered in all directions from the nickel crystal. But what they observed was that there was a maximum. That there was an angle at which the maximum intensity was there, and there was another angle at which the minimum intensity was there. So even though electrons were scattered in all directions from the crystal, the intensity was a minimum at theta equal to 35 degree and maximum at theta equal to 50 degree. Okay. So this means this can only result from constructive interference of scattered electrons, because there was some light and dark region. And that light dark region type of thing can only occur when there is constructive interference of scattered electrons. Constructive interference is a property of waves, right? So only when there is constructive interference, you see such kind of a pattern. Now, then they also, because this is a nickel crystal, it will have some planes, okay? Because crystals always have these layers of atoms arranged properly in a very organized fashion. So there are these planes, and these planes are called Bragg planes. Okay, so they can actually relate the first maximum of the Bragg formula. So the intensity maximum of scattered electron actually corresponded to the first maximum of the Bragg formula. So the Bragg formula is n lambda equal to 2d sine phi. The first maximum meaning that n is equal to 1. So they can get the formula for lambda. Right, so lambda is nothing but 2d sine phi, and d is the spacing between the planes, okay, in the nickel crystal. So so we know what the spacing is, we know what phi is, because we know what the maximum is. Maximum is 50 degree, right, for theta. So if we know what the maximum, let's calculate it here. Okay, so for a nickel crystal, spacing between Bragg planes d is known, which is 0.091 nanometer. Now, since only one maximum is seen, so at theta equal to 50 degree, we can now do 2 phi plus theta equal to 180, right? So this complete angle is theta, and plus 2 phi, you are going to get 180 degree if you add all of them. So with that, you can find out what phi is, okay? All right, so you, so you find out what phi is. So phi turns out to be 65 degree. With this phi, now you know d, you know phi, so you can calculate what lambda is. Okay, so lambda turns out to be some point, I forget the value, but you can check it out what lambda is. Okay, So I didn't use the calculator, but you should use the calculator and check it out while studying. Okay, now let's do the same calculation for lambda, but using the de Broglie relation. So what is the de Broglie relation? De Broglie relation is lambda is equal to h by p. So we know that the energy, the kinetic energy of the electron beam was 54 electron volt, because I already told you in the beginning that electron beam is coming with an energy of 54 electron volt. So that is the kinetic energy of electron. So from the kinetic energy, you can obviously get the momentum of electron, right? So p is going to be nothing but, so kinetic energy is half mv square, which is nothing but 1 by 2m into p square. So momentum of electron is nothing but root of 2 into mass of electron into the kinetic energy. Okay. So from this PE, now you substitute this PE here, you'll get the value for lambda. Okay. So again, I want you to calculate, just use the calculator and see what the value of lambda is. And you will see that surprisingly, the lambda calculated using this formula and the lambda calculating using this formula is exactly the same. Not exactly, there is some difference at the third decimal place, okay, third or fourth decimal place, but it is very nearly the same. Okay. All right. So lambda.
Ma'am, why we took theta equal to 50 degree?
Sorry, say that again.
Why we took theta equal to 50 degree?
Ah, so because the maximum, so they observed in the experiment, okay, in the experiment they saw that the maximum intensity that you got was at theta equal to 50 degree, okay. And if you use, and because this is reflected from a nickel crystal, so you have to use the Bragg formula to get what is the lambda where the maximum is. So the maximum, so this n, okay, this n corresponds to the first maximum. Okay, and they observed only one maximum in this, but that maximum was at 50 degree, and n refers to the maximum. So if you observe two maximums, then n can be 1 and 2. But they observed only one maximum, and the first maximum was n equal to 1. Okay, so obviously this angle is 50 degree, because you are going to use this formula only for the maximum intensity. So the angle, you know that theta is 50 degree, so you can compute what is phi using theta plus 2 phi equal to 180 degree from here. Okay. All right. So what I was telling you was that lambda calculated from the de Broglie formula and lambda calculated from the Bragg formula, they are very nearly the same. Okay, which means that de Broglie relation is valid. Okay, it is an excellent agreement with experiment value. Okay, so now since Bragg formula provided an excellent accurate prediction of the electron's interference fringes, motion of an electron with momentum p must be described by a plane wave. So essentially what they're saying is, Bragg formula is providing an accurate description of the electron's interference fringes, because these at the detector, okay, so at this detector you are getting some interference pattern. There is light region, dark region, so it goes like that. So if there is light region, dark region like that, that is the interference pattern. So because electron is showing interference pattern, that means electron is behaving like a wave, and so you have to write electron in terms of a plane wave type of formula. So electron can be written, so psi of r comma t, so the position, so r represents the position, right, and t is the time. So this so motion of an electron with momentum p must be described by a plane wave. Okay, so if you write the equation for a wave, this is the equation, that general equation that you get. So A is the amplitude, and then e power I into k dot r minus omega t. Okay, so if the wave is moving in time, then you have to include the omega t part. If it is not moving, then t is of course 0. Okay, now so k dot r, k represents the wave vector. Okay, so now you can see, if you now use the de Broglie relation, you can substitute, instead of k you will get p by h cross, and instead of omega you will get E by H cross, energy by H cross. So you can represent the motion of an electron by a plane wave, and the wave equation and the momentum of the electron are related to each other. So this is something that de Broglie and Bragg, and after their experiment and theory, this was brought about. Okay, so this was proposed. Okay, so then there is the second experiment. Yeah.
Ma'am, what is vector R here?
So vector r is the position of electron. So
Okay.
r represents the way at any. So of course, in a wave, you are going to have you are or you always represent wave in terms of r, right? So psi versus r or something. So you can represent so r is like the position vector. Okay. So r is obviously the position vector, t is the time, and you can represent the motion of electron using the wave. So this is what was proposed, because you saw that electrons gave rise to interference patterns or these interference fringes. Okay, so next is the Thomson experiment. Okay, so I told you there were two pioneering experiments. So second experiment is the Thomson experiment. So here what they did was they diffracted electrons through a polycrystalline thin film. So they had a polycrystalline thin film, and there was an incident electron beam. And once it interacted, once these ele this electron beam interacted with the thin film, there was scattering of electrons. And then there was a photographic plate at the other end, and you could see that there are these interference patterns. So there is again like light region, dark region, light region, dark region, kind of a interference pattern. Okay, so this again shows that particle exhibits wave-like constructive interference pattern. Okay, so obviously electron shows wave-like behavior. This is what it means. Okay, all right. So this is again a small homework where you just have to plug in the numbers and get the answer. In scattering electrons from a crystal, first maximum is observed at an angle 60 degrees. So here theta is equal to 60 degrees. What must be the energy of the electrons that will enable us to probe as deep as 19 nanometer inside the crystal? Okay, so 19 nanometer, so D is given for you, right? You have to find the energy of the electron. So pretty simple, I think. Okay. All right, so now I have told you about particle aspect of waves. Then I have also told you about wave aspect of particles. Okay, so the main takeaway from all this is that all objects, whether microscopic or macroscopic, display wave behavior. Okay, just that the lambda, the wavelength for macroscopic objects, is negligible in comparison to the size of the macroscopic object. Okay. So if the wavelength is comparable to the size of the object, then you say that you cannot ignore the wave behavior. So for an electron, for example, if the wavelength, right, if the wavelength is comparable to the size of electron or is greater than the size of electron, then you cannot neglect the wave property of the electron. But for a ball of, like a tennis ball or something, you will see, if you calculate the wavelength, you will see that the wavelength is negligible compared to the size of the object, which is the tennis ball, for example. And so you can neglect the wave behavior of that object. Okay, because that is not important, because we cannot really distinguish, or like using any instrument or anything, we cannot really distinguish what is the wave property there. Okay, so we can neglect it. Okay. All right, so this I've already told you. For microscopic objects like electrons, protons, atoms, etc., wavelength is similar or greater than the size of the object. Therefore, in this case, we cannot neglect the wave property of particles. So this is a very small problem. So you only have to calculate the de Broglie wavelength for these two. Okay, so I gave you this problem because I want you to appreciate like what is the difference in wavelength. Okay, so I've also given you the answer. You just have to verify that you're actually getting this. Okay. So calculate de Broglie wavelength for a proton of kinetic energy 70 MeV. Okay, and also for a 100 gram bullet moving at 900 meter per second. So if you calculate, you will get, so I have also written down the answer, you'll get wavelength of proton is 3.4 into 10 power minus 15 meters. Okay, now this wavelength is nearly same as the size of a typical atomic nucleus. Okay, so which means you cannot really neglect the quantum effect or the wave property of the proton. Okay, but now wavelength of bullet, if you calculate using these numbers that I've given you, if you calculate the wavelength of bullet, you're going to get 7.4 into 10 power minus 36. Please verify this. Okay, please verify that I've written this correctly. But you're going to get something very small. So this is 10 power minus 36 meters. Okay, wavelength of bullet. So this is too small compared to the size of the object, right? The size of the object, 100 gram, obviously it is some size that you can see with your naked eye. So compared to that, this 10 power minus 36 meter is just too small. It is too small even compared to the wavelength of proton even. So then that means you can neglect the wave property of the bullet. So there is no quantum effect in the bullet, but there is a quantum effect in the proton, and which you cannot neglect. Okay. So that's the main takeaway from this, that wavelength of microscopic objects are finite and display easily discernible wave-like patterns. Okay, so you can see the wave-like patterns. But wavelength of macroscopic objects are infinitesimally small, and therefore no observable wave-like behavior. You will not see any wave-like behavior. So when wavelength goes to zero, approaches zero, then wave-like properties disappear. So this is the main takeaway from these first two lectures of mine that I've told you so far, that you cannot neglect the wave-like property of quantum particles or microscopic particles, but you can neglect the wave-like property of macroscopic objects. All objects will display some wave-like property, but then it is like whether it is negligible or whether you have to actually take it into consideration. That is the whole game here. And then I've already told you the particle aspect of waves and the wave aspect of particles. So I think I will stop here now. And in the next lecture, we will look at the double slit experiment. I think that is something that you might have heard before, but we will look at it in detail and see what is, like, what are the differences you get when you look at classical particles versus quantum particles, and then we'll see what they are. Okay? All right, so I'll stop here. Let me know if you have any questions.